Tantor Audio, a division of Recorded Books, presents Immigration, an American History by Carl J. Bontempo and Hasia R. Diner. Narrated by Kathleen Li. My heart is filled with optimism. My dreams are so close to coming true. But the same cannot be said for others. Kyla Alto, Eyes of an Immigrant. Introduction. Immigration, an American History. A young man with few skills, fewer resources, and no real prospects at home, John W. Nordstrom left his hardscrabble farm in Alvik Nader Luleå in northern Sweden in 1887. He headed to the United States. After some early struggles, he and a friend from back home decided to take laborers' jobs in an iron mine in Stambaugh, Michigan. "We knew we could get jobs there," he recalled. "They always needed men," he remembered. "And greenhorns like us were the only ones the mine operators could get, as no American would work there." Nordstrom eventually found his way to Seattle, Washington, where he opened a successful shoe store. He and his heirs turned that enterprise into a high-end department store, Nordstrom, a staple of large shopping malls in the latter part of the 20th century. A shoe dang, at first glance, shared little with John Nordstrom. Born in southern Sudan in the 1980s and orphaned at age 6 during a civil war, she fled to refugee camps in Kenya and then Ethiopia. In 2000, a U.S. government program for Sudanese orphan refugees brought her to America. She went to college and ended up in Sioux Falls, South Dakota, working at a massive Smithfield pork processing plant. She started on the processing line, using a knife to cut fat from the hanging carcasses, and advanced to shift manager, a less physically taxing and more lucrative position. Eventually earning over $18 an hour, plus overtime, she gave her three boys a life she could only have dreamt of as a child. "It's not a perfect world. I'd make it perfect for them," she noted, as she reflected on her efforts with pride and satisfaction. But then, in the spring of 2020, her workplace experienced a massive outbreak of coronavirus, which exposed Dang and so many others to the lethal virus. She got sick, and the plant shut for weeks. When it reopened, Dang returned to work. She needed the money, but all the while she worried about her health, her finances, and the future. "I cannot afford to stay home for a long time." Nordstrom and Dang, two different people from different parts of the globe at different times and facing different challenges, both came to the United States to craft better futures for themselves. For them, and the tens of millions of others whose stories unfold in these chapters, the United States represented a new start. Many came with the dreams of economic security, hoping to match their industriousness to economic opportunities in the United States. Others came to escape religious or political persecution and aim to enjoy privileges that the United States offered. For still others, the aftershocks of natural disasters played decisive roles in pushing them outward. Finally, many newcomers came to reunite with family members who had preceded them to the United States. The chance that Nordstrom or Dang or any of the others could in fact accomplish their migration goals depended on their ability to navigate multiple intersecting dynamics, both in the places they sought to leave and in the place they hoped to enter, the United States. Governments, motivated by a mix of popular cultural and social attitudes, economic imperatives, and foreign policy concerns, could make it easier or harder for immigrants to leave or enter. Immigrants called on the latest in communications technologies to learn of opportunities in the United States and to arrange their travels and resettlement plans. They also depended on transportation networks at both ends of their journeys to ease their passage across borders and facilitate their resettlement. Whether in the mid-19th century, when John Nordstrom grabbed a shovel in Michigan, or the early 21st, when Ashu Deng picked up her meat cleaver in the pork plant in South Dakota, and indeed in centuries earlier, immigrants stoked the material, physical, social, and cultural development of the United States. The vast growth of the American economy depended on the willingness of individuals to leave their homes elsewhere and exchange their physical strength and mental acuity for pay. The kinds of work they performed changed, but the recognition that without them, the work could not get done persisted. Away from their jobs, in their communities every day, those same immigrants brought much to America's social fabric, both reinforcing and reinventing it. Yet at the same time, Americans consistently articulated deep fears that every new contingent of immigrants threatened the United States. Such arguments might seem inconsistent with historic realities, but at each moment in time, some Americans expressed the opinion, stating it as fact, that newcomers took work away from Americans by selling their labor for low rates of pay. They likewise, throughout this long history, deemed all or some immigrants to be less desirable, more dangerous, and more markedly defective than the ones who came before. At various times, Americans feared and reviled the political beliefs, religious practices, and physical appearances of the newcomers. Some Americans abhorred immigrants as speakers of languages other than English, as bearers of cultures that seemed to jar with American ways of living, and as women and men still tied to their faraway communities. And yet, women and men from around the world voted for America with their feet. If they could make their way to America, they did. In the colonial period, indentured servants recruited from England, Scotland, Ireland, and various German-speaking states arrived, women and men who provided the labor to farm the soil of North America. In the 19th century, men from Ireland, Central, Eastern, and Southern Europe, Mexico, China, and India entered the United States, willing to dynamite the earth, blast away at the mountains, and lay the tracks to build a network of canals, roads, and railroads. They were joined by Irish Catholic women who labored in the homes of Americans, cooking, cleaning, and tending children. In the 20th century, immigrants, largely from Europe, worked the industries that spat out mammoth amounts of textiles, garments, machines, rubber, steel, and automobiles, while newcomers, many from Mexico and the Caribbean, harvested and processed the food that found its way to dinner tables across the country. In the 21st century, Chinese, Indian, Mexican, and Central American newcomers continue to do some of the most difficult and least desirable, but absolutely crucial, work in the country. These are only some of the stories of the newcomers who inhabit this book. As these examples suggest, we give primary significance to the economic matters in explaining the United States immigration history. The declining chances of women and men of particular classes and regions to make a living at home motivated many to leave their current place of residence. North America's labor needs, meanwhile, drew them in particular to the United States. All this occurred within, and often because of, the interconnected global economy that knit together people and regions around the world. The economic context was, and remains today, a vital driver of immigration to the United States. But it was not the only one. Families, wives and husbands, parents and children, immigrated in order to reunite with loved ones. Even here, though, the labor imperative was not far away. Individuals often reunited with their family who had come to the United States earlier for work. Other troubling conditions, including religious, political, and racial persecution back home, also propelled them outward. That dynamic connects Central Europeans in the 1840s, Eastern European Jews in the late 19th century, German Jews in the 1930s, Indo-Chinese in the 1970s, and today's Central Americans across the breadth of immigration history. But even for individuals who suffered persecution, the inability to make a living in one place and the possibility of doing so in the United States influenced individual, family, and community choices more profoundly. If work and the nation's labor need stand as one pillar at the heart of this book, then the state, the local state or federal governments, emerges as the other key pillar. The federal government facilitated John Nordstrom's options, since as a young man defined by both law and by common practice as white, he faced no legal restriction or impediments to immigration. He arrived before the government of the United States restricted which whites from Europe and how many could immigrate, when and how, and if they could remain permanently and become citizens. Nordstrom in 1887 handily fit and benefited from the dictates of the still relevant Naturalization Act of 1790, which defined as eligible for citizenship anyone deemed to be a free white person of good character. For people coming from any part of Europe until the 1920s, immigration, though increasingly regulated, proceeded without a numerical ceiling or any quotas based on place of origin. The millions who took advantage of that comparatively free flow across the Atlantic experienced immigration as a personal choice relatively unfettered by the actions of the U.S. government. State-based rules that demanded the deportation of paupers, real or potential, colored the experiences of some immigrants, and they demonstrate that the United States never had a completely open door to newcomers. But enforcement of these laws and policies was kept at a minimum, and, in the big picture, they did not stem the movement of tens of millions. But 5 years before Nordstrom's arrival, the Chinese Exclusion Act of 1882 did exactly what its name declared. The federal government made it impossible, with minor exceptions, for individuals from China to immigrate to the United States. 3 years later, Congress legislated against the immigration of contract labor, directed also against potential Chinese immigrants and Italians, though without explicitly naming either. From then on, Congress defined new categories of women and men as ineligible to immigrate, whether on the basis of class, gender, and sexuality, physical and mental disability, or political affiliation. By the 1920s, this restrictionist impulse reached its apogee with federal legislation that created a quota system for immigrants that was based on national origin. Congress ended the national origins quotas in 1965, but the new system it crafted placed numerical restrictions on immigration from the Western Hemisphere for the first time. After that year, government policies categorized newcomers in new ways. For instance, for the first time declaring some to be refugees entitled to entry, and others denied that label and barred from access. As various states and then the federal government sought to regulate and sometimes restrict immigration, they created administrative and bureaucratic structures to oversee enforcement. The mechanisms of enforcement at times took on law enforcement or military trappings as armed agents stood, often literally, at the borders. At other times, a web of courts and administrative bodies passed judgment on whether a newcomer could enter the United States. Finally, the United States, especially in the 20th century, built what one historian has called the deportation machine to remove newcomers under a variety of political and legal pretexts. The changing role of local, state, and federal governments brought immigration squarely into the fractious realm of politics, parties, and public opinion, where it had been even in the pre-national period. The ways in which Americans, particularly native-born whites, responded to the new arrivals, and how these responses left their mark on political and public life, emerge as a theme in this book. In that history of politics, the public, and immigration, Americans have simultaneously welcomed and rejected, lauded and reviled immigrants. They have debated and divided over issues, such as whether immigrants strengthen or harm, enrich or impoverish the nation. Could immigrants become American, and how and what did that mean? At different times, Irish, Chinese, Italians, and Mexicans loomed especially menacing in the popular imagination. Their sheer presence, according to some Americans, seemed to jeopardize the very nature of the social, cultural, and political order. Fear of these immigrants caused the American public and the state to respond with force. The state played another noteworthy role in immigration. It took up the task of counting newcomers. But the seemingly straightforward assignment of noting who and how many arrived in the United States and from where was not such a simple proposition, nor was it simple to determine how to label those newcomers. Were they refugees, immigrants, asylees, or non-immigrant visitors? To name just a few of the bureaucratic categories that the federal government developed over the years? Still, the federal government tried. In 1819, it began to require masters of ships carrying immigrants to the shores of the new nation to declare the number of immigrants they had carried across the Atlantic. But ship companies and captains fulfilled this obligation haphazardly, and federal officials only haphazardly enforced it. Moreover, the law did not specify clearly who was an immigrant and what that meant. Instead, information told essentially where ships had come from, but little about where the individuals had lived before making the voyage. Later in the 19th century, with the opening of the immigrant receiving stations at the ports of New York, Philadelphia, Boston, and elsewhere, figures became somewhat more reliable, but not completely so. For example, only women and men traveling in steerage and third class, the least expensive tickets, were listed as immigrants. Those whose family members already in the United States could afford to send them tickets for second-class accommodations were not counted as such. Some immigrants, then, eluded the attention of officials gathering the data at the ports of disembarkation. In the 20th century, the federal government and the public became more concerned with unauthorized migration. But this raised a vexing question. How do you count individuals who are not supposed to be in the United States and who do not present themselves to border officials or census takers? The U.S. government and a variety of non-governmental organizations devised statistical methods to estimate this unauthorized population. But these approaches are hardly infallible. Even good statistical estimates remain estimates after all. The federal government's reports and publications on immigration admit the sketchiness of the available numbers and the inability to truly answer questions about how many and from where. The Historical Statistics of the United States, issued by no less authoritative a body than the U.S. Census in 1949, reported that since 1820, the first year after the passage of the Steerage Act, official immigration statistics have changed considerably in completeness and in the basis of reporting, implying the incompleteness of the whole body of data. For historians, then, guesswork, interpretation, and informed judgment calls have had as much to do with making sense of immigration statistics as do the official figures that we also rely on. No history of immigration would be complete without thinking about the ongoing conversations between sending and receiving societies. Once immigrants settled in America, they sent back news and money in the form of remittances to family members who had stayed put. The information and funds fostered further migration, as immigrants earmarked some part of their wages, no matter how paltry, to bring over loved ones to join them in America. In America, they found ways to recreate elements of their old homes, albeit in new forms. Not every newcomer stayed in the United States. Some immigrants returned to their places of origin. Some traveled back and forth, crossing borders repeatedly. Whether they went for brief visits or they hoped to settle down permanently in their home countries, they carried knowledge, goods, and often money from America. Those items and people traveled faster as technologies of communication and transportation improved, quickening the pace of immigration to the United States from across the globe. This dynamic relationship between sending and receiving countries and regions shaped every immigrant's experiences and the places they came to and from. no sending-receiving relationship in American immigration history is more important than the one between the United States and Mexico. The migration history between the two countries, as much as the more familiar story of European migration, stands at the center of American immigration history. Large portions of what is now the United States belonged to Mexico until the mid-19th century. The peoples of that region, whether Mexican, American, or indigenous, moved fairly freely across that territory, often in search of work, but also to visit and reunite with family. A unique American-Mexican Native hybrid society developed that deeply influenced all aspects of life and immigration. Those well-worn tracks continued into the 20th century as more Mexicans desired to come to the United States and as Americans sought to employ them. That migration grew even as the U.S. government began to guard and fortify its border with Mexico. The development of a more tangible border set in motion other dynamics, such as the bulking up of the Border Patrol, attention to a so-called illegal immigration problem, and new patterns of immigration and settlement that did much to shape culture in the United States. All this also points to the global nature of the United States immigration history. Immigration functioned as one very important way that the colonies, and then the United States, interacted with the rest of the world. United States diplomacy, military interventions, and foreign economic relations sometimes eased, sometimes impeded, and sometimes even sparked immigration to the United States. Unsurprisingly, the country's immigration history is deeply embedded in the country's history as a continental and overseas empire. Building the American empire required disposing of Native Americans and then encouraging immigrants to repopulate and transform that territory. The United States' overseas holdings, won in the late 19th and early 20th centuries, proved just as important. Individuals in those near and far-flung colonies and territories, such as Puerto Rico and the Philippines, entered more easily than they would have otherwise, taking advantage of their place in the American empire. But, as imperial subjects and racial minorities, these newcomers still found themselves in a subordinate position compared especially to European immigrants. Thus, the history of immigration to America cannot be disassociated from the nation's long and abiding obsession with race, another theme of our narrative. The history of race and the changing definitions of that word, for the most part, fell along a white-non-white divide. Immigrants from Europe, from Ireland and Italy, the Balkans and the Baltics, the Austro-Hungarian and the Tsarist empires, encountered discrimination and endured ugly rhetoric that depicted them variously as criminal, ignorant, primitive, defective, and wild. But as people defined by law as white, they had access to citizenship and state protections. Even the harsh laws of the 1920s that assigned them low entry quotas allowed some, however limited the numbers, to enter the United States as legal immigrants and to pursue naturalization. Not so women and men defined by the state as non-white. Millions sought to immigrate from a region designated in 1917 by Congress as the Asiatic Barred Zone, which defined these human beings as literally inadmissible. Race shaped the realities of immigration, but non-European, non-white immigrants nevertheless chose America. While aware of rampant racism, people from China, Japan, Korea, the Indian subcontinent, and the West Indies yearned to enter America, as its economic lure outweighed that painful knowledge. No doubt this history of racism, which continues to the present day, weighs heavily still on the minds of newcomers choosing to come to the United States. It also makes their prominence in contemporary immigration that much more remarkable. Indeed, if one considers European immigration the story of the 18th and 19th centuries, and Mexican immigration the story of the 20th century, some recent trends point to immigration from Asia perhaps emerging as the story of the 21st century. It behooves us to say something about what related and crucial topics this book will not include, although not including them does not deny their centrality to the American historical narrative. It will not explore ethnicity, the complex multi-generational undertaking by which immigrants and their descendants built communities and fashioned novel cultural practices and identities in their new land. Other works have addressed this vital phenomenon in great detail, building careful histories of how immigrant communities took root and were transformed over time in the United States. This book, for the most part, stops at the point of arrival and earliest settlement, focusing most intently on the comings and sometimes goings of various newcomers and the economic forces, political structures, and familial and personal imperatives that attracted them. We do consider how elements of ethnic culture, such as immigrant institutions in the United States, facilitated further movement of family, friends, and others from home communities. In that vein, we pay attention to immigrant aid societies, religious groups, ethnic banks, and cultural and legal institutions that welcomed and sheltered their new arrivals. Additionally, Immigration and American History explores the experiences of the women and men who had some ability to shape their own migrations. The people whose stories appear here exercised a degree of agency as they faced difficulties and dwindling opportunities. They not only chose to emigrate, but often could determine when to go, how, and where. In many, but not all, instances, they could determine which family members went, in what order and combination, if others would follow, and who among them. That some decided to return home also reveals that they exercised an element of control over their own circumstances. Not all these immigrants had the same degree of agency, of course. Women and children often had fewer opportunities to participate in these discussions about immigration choices, and they had fewer choices about where and when to go, how to get there, and how to resettle. The same limitations held for immigrants of color and those from the Global South, as well as individuals fleeing political, religious, or social persecution who probably and accurately felt they had too little control over their migration choices. Ashu Deng, the refugee from Sudan via Kenya and Ethiopia, embodies the complicated, historically contingent hierarchy of immigrant agency that is a key component of the book. Deng had limited choices about where she might go, but she could choose among some options, or she might have remained put, no matter how difficult that environment. Moreover, once in the United States, she could move to a new locale, as she did by finding her way to South Dakota. By telling the story of what scholars used to call voluntary immigrants, we purposely do not include the millions of Africans who arrived in North America as slaves. Their story, and that of their ancestors, might be the most fundamental one to U.S. history, but a bright and stark distinction separates the compelled migrations of the enslaved from the movement with some choice of the immigrants. Slavers forcibly and violently removed Africans from homes and families. Enslaved Africans had no choice about whether to go or to remain, no choice about timing or destination or transport. Nor, obviously, could they choose to return or move to a new location, whether in the United States or elsewhere. These individuals lacked even the circumscribed options of Ashu Deng and others from Africa, the Caribbean, or the larger global Black diaspora, starting in the late 19th century and continuing into the 21st. They, after all, chose the United States, while the enslaved, by virtue of their forced migration, had no choices. At the heart of this book, as the title declares, lies the drama of immigration to America, told through the stories of women and men from the 17th through the 21st centuries, who decided that their homes held out little for them and that America offered them opportunities unavailable if they stayed put. It circumnavigates the globe, starting in a small corner of the North Atlantic, and ultimately spans the planet to include people from every habitable continent. These women and men, after weighing and balancing their life chances at home, immigrated to America. Once there, they created a country and shaped a nation. Chapter 1. Founding Immigrants, 17th and 18th Century America. John Harrower, 40 years old, a shopkeeper in Lerwick in Scotland's Shetland Islands, lamented the growing poverty and withering possibilities for making a living at home. He left his family to search out work, setting off in January 1774 for London. With no clear plan, he considered himself like a blind man without a guide. He wandered the capital city, hitting dead ends everywhere he turned. Being reduced to his last shilling, he happened upon a friend who offered advice that changed everything. Find a ship sailing across the Atlantic, his friend suggested, and then locate the agent of someone from any of Britain's colonies in North America who would pay his fare in exchange for some set years of service. In a letter he sent home and also copied into his diary, he wrote, "I was obliged to engage to go to Virginia for 4 years as a schoolmaster for bed, board, washing, and £5 during the whole time." Along with 71 other men, all with indenture certificates in hand, he boarded a ship, sailed the ocean, and, upon landing safely, began his American life as a tutor for the sons of a Colonel Dangerfield, owner of an estate, Belvedere, near Fredericksburg. The details and tone of John Harrower's story would have resonated with the hundreds of thousands from Scotland, Ireland, Wales, England, and various German-speaking regions who joined the emigration to any one of Britain's 13 North American colonies. His descriptions of the dangers he faced and the risks he took would have echoed in their experiences. Crowding and poor sanitation during the 8 to 12-week journey spawned high levels of onboard mortality. Scurvy and dysentery ran rampant. Storms at sea during the sailings, which typically commenced during the summer, cast many ships into the ocean waters. Immigrants brought their own supplies. No shipping lines existed with published schedules or fixed sailing dates and prices. Sometimes groups consisting of people who knew each other, or just of individuals who met while congregating for weeks on end at the ports, negotiated with ship captains, haggling over the cost of the trip. Despite the difficulties, from the 17th century until the American Revolution in 1776, men first, then women joining them, learned that they could remake their lives in America. With little settlement policy directed by the Crown or Parliament, they peopled the territory between the Atlantic seaboard and the eastern edge of the Appalachian Mountains, the founding beachhead of the United States. Different empires, different settlement policies. As the territory occupied by the United States expanded piecemeal, it incorporated the descendants of women and men who had immigrated to North America through imperial projects launched by Spain, France, and the Netherlands. These European nations believed that they, like Britain, had the right to conquer and occupy territory where native peoples lived, using the land of others to enrich themselves. They, too, sent over administrators, clergy, military, and settlers. All these European nations engaged in settler colonialism, deliberately populating spaces on which others had lived with their own people to do the bidding of their empires. Britain's North American colonies resembled these, but differences existed. Europeans, regardless of religion or place of origin, who wanted and had necessary funds to immigrate to Britain's North American colonies could do so. The other empires fostered more organized, state-directed, and selective settlement programs than the British, who cared little about who settled and where, so long as they worked, did not cost the state much, and participated in the common defense. The British approach left many policies undefined, which allowed administrators in America and investors to decide much about immigration. The other empires pursued more restrictive policies, whether in Mexico, French Canada, New Netherlands, Florida, or the other colonies. State authorities in Madrid, Paris, and Amsterdam exerted greater authority than their London equivalents. In 1685, for example, King Louis XIV promulgated the Code Noir, banning all non-Catholics from settling in any of France's colonies, and expelled the few Jews there. The Spanish Empire, based in Mexico and extending through the southwestern region of the future United States, transported the Inquisition to the New World to root out Jews, former Jews known as conversos or marranos, and other non-Catholics. Dutch officials in New Amsterdam wanted to expel a group of 23 Jews who arrived in 1654, though the Dutch West Indies Company, which governed the colony, objected it, denied Jews the right of public worship or trading outside the city in the larger New Netherlands. 10 years later, the British took over, renamed the colony New York, and wiped out the restrictions. Encouraging immigration and doing nothing to discourage it. Britain's policy did not reflect an ideology of tolerance or a belief in pluralism. It put profits first, placing few obstacles in the way of individuals who got themselves over the ocean and worked. Individuals contemplating immigrating to the British North America, like John Harrower, never dealt with state officials, negotiating instead on their own with shipowners and the agents of colonial employers. British policymakers valued immigration as a way to siphon off young people, individuals, and families whose increasing poverty might cause them to become troublesome at home and render them financial burdens on their communities. Those same women and men, once residing in North America, would produce goods and services to benefit the empire. The British state did try to play some role in the emigration process, although never consistently or rigorously. Potential emigrants had to get permission from local authorities to leave, and British officials from the onset demanded that Englishmen going to the colonies promise to remain loyal. In the 1630s, immigrants sailing from Bristol had to show papers signed by a member of the clergy, attesting to their good character. At various times, officials in some British towns collaborated with immigration recruiters, allowing them to pluck men and women out of prison and ship them off to the colonies. This worked for the recruiters who got paid by how many bodies they brought over, and for the town officials who no longer had to provide for the prisoners. It was a practice unpopular among the British residents of the colonies, and local Virginia officials in 1697 refused to allow the docking of convict transport ships. Parliament, however, saw the matter differently and wanted the practice to continue. In 1718, it enacted the Transportation Act, which sought to create a more rational approach to keep the system alive. In the three quarters of a century, culminating in 1775, over 20,000 felons disembarked in Virginia. The groundswell for immigration grew with economic changes in Britain. Growing numbers of people could not adjust to economic changes brought about by early industrialization and the demise of common grazing lands that had existed for centuries. True, some immigrants came from England's better-off classes. A small coterie received patents or grants of land from the crown, many of whom settled in the southern colonies. They became the owners of plantations. They then recruited larger numbers of poor women and men who negotiated labor contracts and immigrated to America, hoping to achieve a more livable life. The story of America in the centuries under British rule constitutes an immigration story. Everyone of European background owed their lives in America to immigrant origins, whether their own, their parents, or their grandparents. All exercised a degree of choice in their decision to opt for the British colonies of North America. Even convicts, at times, had a choice, inasmuch as judges and other carceral personnel offered them the option of going to America or languishing in prison. Some small numbers came as members of religious communities, emigrating together, including Calvinists bound for Massachusetts, Quakers who went to Pennsylvania, and French Huguenots who built communities in New York, New Jersey, and the Carolinas, joined there by German Pietists and Anabaptists. But even they considered the economic promise of America. Colonial officials, investors, wealthy landowners, ship captains, Importers and exporters on both sides of the Atlantic all had a keen interest in bringing over, by whatever means, streams of men and women to the colonies, ensuring that those who arrived worked. But as more people left their homes and settled in the North American colonies, the more attractive life became there. An idea spread throughout Europe of America as a place where persons of humble means could, despite uncertainties, end their lives more comfortably situated than when they had started out. Though embodying a common story across the long history of immigration, this era presented some distinctive characteristics. The native peoples of North America and the immigrants who met them. Colonial-era immigration differed from that of later eras because of the proximity and active presence of multiple nations of native peoples, erroneously called Indians by Europeans. Native peoples lived on and defended territory that Britain claimed as its domain and opened up for immigrant settlement. European newcomers understood that they had migrated to a vast battle zone, punctuated by sporadic fighting, sparked by native peoples' resistance to the loss of their homelands. Fear of attack hung over the immigrants' heads, particularly in the 17th century and beyond that in the western fringes of the colonies. That danger influenced policies enacted by colonial officials as they considered immigration recruiting. Decision makers, particularly locally elected representatives, believed that planting immigrant settlements in the western regions of the colonies could subdue the native population by inhabiting the territory between seaboard port cities and the farms and towns closer to the coast and the deeper interior. Pennsylvania officials considered Protestant immigrants from Ulster, the northern part of Ireland, particularly suited for life in the far western mountainous region. Colonial elites in Philadelphia, adherents to the pacifist Quaker faith, could not themselves pick up arms to fight the Lenni-Lenape, Iroquois, Tuscarora, and others. But they wanted others to go to the frontier, work, and stave off Indian attacks. They encouraged the Ulster newcomers, people not burdened by such religious principles, as perfect buffers. Immigrants came from a variety of places. English women and Englishmen made up the dominant core, although the label English obscured pre-migration differences. Most English immigrants who went to the northern colonies of New England, starting in the middle of the 17th century, immigrated from East Anglia, while those who opted for Virginia hailed from the south of England. Many English immigrants bound for the middle colonies, like Delaware, originated in England's Midlands, whereas at the end of the 17th century, immigrants from the north of England and the Celtic fringe went to the backcountry at the edge of the Appalachian Mountains. Each brought distinctive foodways, modes of agriculture, marriage patterns, language, accents, religious practices, and architectural styles for houses and barns. The importance of place, the northern colonies. Immigrants in this period, as in later centuries, moved along family and kinship chains, favoring particular destinations over others. Each region had its own immigrant mix. The more northern British colonies attracted the least varied immigrant pool. Massachusetts, New Hampshire, Rhode Island, and Connecticut consisted primarily of people from England, as well as some from Wales, Scotland, and Ulster, known as Scotch-Irish. Though they hailed from the British Isles, they did not identify as English. Immigrants from England, likewise, did not consider that they all shared a common place of origin. Non-English immigrants constituted about 30% of the population of the region that in the 18th century came to be known, perhaps accurately, as New England. The initial immigrants to Massachusetts and the other northern colonies, small independent farmers whose descendants would become America's elite, came primarily from East Anglia. Their decision to immigrate starting in the 1620s reflected the pressures of overpopulation, the enclosure of common lands, and escalating land prices, which prevented young men from settling down as farmers and young women from marrying. This first immigration generation paid its own fare. Few arrived as indentured servants. Some single women who immigrated worked briefly in domestic service, then married men who owned their own small farms. America's national narrative, consumed most powerfully every November at Thanksgiving, focuses on the Pilgrims, who called themselves separatists and arrived in Plymouth in 1620. It depicts them as seekers of religious freedom, not as economically motivated immigrants. So, too, American collective memory has described the settlement of New England in general as driven by religiously motivated Puritans who chose the rigors of Massachusetts over persecution in England. But that story defies historical fact. The 20,000 or so who arrived in Massachusetts between 1628 and 1642 came under the aegis of a royal charter granted to the Massachusetts Bay Company. Attracted to a place graced with a fine natural harbor, these people of middling economic circumstances from southwestern England gambled like others that, despite many difficulties, migration to America offered greater economic prospects than staying put. The place to which they moved shaped the region's colonial-era migrations. Its relatively poor, rocky soil kept farms from expanding dramatically. They needed few non-family laborers. Non-farming enterprises, such as coastal water fishing, also did not require sizable pools of workers. Those colonies invested little in immigrant recruiting. Full families migrated. Women and men arrived in relatively equal numbers. Populations grew steadily, as the region enjoyed relatively low mortality and high fertility. The bumper crops of children born and surviving infancy then labored alongside parents, doing work that elsewhere depended on laborers. Some sons inherited parents' farms and married, while non-inheritors pressed farther west, looking for cheap or even free land on which Mohegans and Wampanoag lived. Immigration to this region continued modestly after the initial Great Migration of the 1620s and 1630s. Nearly all newcomers came as East Anglian chain migrants, relatives, and townspeople of those men and women already living there, so the ethnic makeup changed little with time. The Mid-Atlantic. The Mid-Atlantic colonies of New York, New Jersey, and Pennsylvania attracted the greatest number and variety of immigrants. In 1700, fewer than half of the residents of New York and New Jersey, and less than one quarter of Pennsylvanians, traced their lineage to England. Micro-regions of the Mid-Atlantic drew from women and men who had come from the Netherlands, Ulster, other parts of Ireland, France, and, in Pennsylvania in particular, certain German states and created scattered enclaves. The Mid-Atlantic became such a powerful immigration magnet, in part because the key Atlantic ports, New York, Philadelphia, and Baltimore, served as gateways for merchants, craftsmen, and seamen from all over Europe. Though Italian immigration to the United States would not commence until centuries later, some handful of Italian speakers already lived in New Amsterdam even before it became New York in 1664, and Philadelphia housed a small Italian community on the eve of the American Revolution. Though mid-Atlantic cities boasted multiple immigrant communities, most immigrants moved west to the hinterlands. The second quarter of the 18th century saw the largest influx of German and Dutch newcomers. 80,000 arrived between 1710 and 1775 and spread out in the interior from the port of Philadelphia. By the 1750s, immigrants from German states made up almost one-third of Pennsylvania's population. Emigrants from southwestern Germany's Rhine Valley and others from Switzerland and the Low Countries participated in a vast global migration. American recruiters actively sought them out. News of America spread among family and friends as those already working in Pennsylvania or any of the mid-Atlantic colonies wrote home, stimulating a vigorous flow across the Atlantic. Referred to as the frivolous itch of emigration, this movement outward concerned local officials in some 18th century German states, who worried that as more left, particularly the young and able-bodied, the more restive those who remained would become. Although they hoped to do so, government officials could do little to restrain those yearning for Pennsylvania, what they called Pennsylvania. That powerful, itch, inspired some hopeful immigrants to create formal immigration societies to collectively handle the many details involved. Most new immigrants to the middle colonies moved beyond the coast, finding cheap and fertile land, perfect for small family farms that could grow and prosper. Many who started as indentured servants became owners of comfortable, even profitable farms. One of these immigrants dubbed Pennsylvania the best poor man's country. Immigrants, regardless of place of origin, could work for someone else, pay back the fare, and transition to independent farming. Indenture contracts offered cash or land in exchange for completing the term of service. And, once liberated from employment, the immigrant could take the cash and move farther west to cheaper land. Few became wealthy, but families could achieve land ownership and better living. Even less expensive, often free, land existed in the backcountry. Between 1700 and 1775, 200,000 immigrants, mostly Protestants from Ulster, flocked to Pennsylvania. Substantial numbers spread farther south to Virginia and the Carolinas. They gravitated to the foothills of the Appalachian region, and some over time even penetrated the mountains themselves. Originally known simply as Irish, in later centuries, they called themselves Scotch-Irish to distinguish themselves from the Catholic Irish, who arrived in massive numbers in the mid-19th century. These immigrants might be considered the quintessential frontier people, the first European occupants of a zone of land that at the end of the 19th century, the historian Frederick Jackson Turner would pinpoint as the central space of American history and culture, the meeting point between savagery and civilization. According to Turner, newcomers from Ireland, poor and landless upon arrival, gave America its national character, bequeathing it with its coarseness and strength combined with acuteness and acquisitiveness. Turner asserted that these immigrants originated Americans' fierce commitment to individualism. More than others, Ulster immigrants came into direct contact and conflict with native peoples. They fought the Indians, defenders of their homelands, engaging in battle from New Hampshire to Carolina. In Pennsylvania, they fought against the Iroquois, pressing the ruling Philadelphia Quakers for more resources to subdue the enemy. Ulster frontiersmen also served as middlemen in the highly lucrative global trade in pelts and timber and in land negotiations between merchants in the East and the various native nations. These transactions, handled by Scots-Irish immigrants, produced great profits for London business interests. Backcountry Ulster immigrants also shaped American independence. They smarted from King George III's decision to limit Western expansion beyond the crest of the Appalachian Mountains. The proclamation of 1763 banned settlement in the territory Britain had won from France during the French and Indian War, 1754 to 1763. Considering that it infringed on their freedom, these immigrant residents of the backcountry rallied against it. The Declaration of Independence listed this as one grievance against the king. Immigrants to the Southern Colonies. A line ran through the Southern Colonies, dividing them into upper and lower regions, both with distinctive immigration histories. The upper colonies included Maryland and Virginia, while Georgia and both North and South Carolina, which had been a single colony until 1712, constituted the lower ones. Neither attracted many non-English immigrants. Relatively few from outside England chose the South. Immigrants to the Upper South divided unequally between the second and third sons of British aristocrats, called Cavaliers, who made up the small elite, and a much larger population of indentured servants. The latter far outnumbered the former, and by the American Revolution, they and their immediate descendants made up over 75% of the Southern population. They shared pre-migration geographic origins with their social and economic betters, but in so many other ways they differed. The elite, adherents to the Church of England and supporters of the Royalists, came first. Many fled England in the 1650s, the period of Puritan rule under Oliver Cromwell. They sat at the top of the Upper South's social, political, and economic hierarchy, having seized the most fertile swaths of land in the Tidewater region. They established large holdings on valuable acreage astride transportation routes along the region's rivers. They grew the region's single crop that defined and shaped it, tobacco. As early as the 1620s, Chesapeake planters in Virginia and Maryland began cultivating the stinking weed, selling it in England to an increasingly addicted public. Tobacco rapidly depleted the soil. Growers needed to expand their holdings on new fertile soil, which then called for an ever-expanding labor force. That call determined the region's history. The importation of Africans commenced in 1619. The first did not come as chattel slaves, but as indentured servants. But that was changed by the middle of the 17th century. As of the 1680s, the system of perpetual hereditary slavery took root, whereby skin color was the defining line between freedom and enslavement. Planters in Virginia, Maryland, and Carolina also hoped to recruit in England, preferring white workers with contracts. Between 1619 and 1680, about 5,000 men and a few women, the first of whom disembarked in Williamsburg in 1619, arrived at the request of Edwin Sandys, treasurer of the Virginia Company. Most of the immigrants came via the port of Bristol, having been recruited by Chesapeake landowners. The number of relatively poor English people willing to emigrate as indentured servants bound for Virginia and Maryland declined in the 1660s, in reaction to news that land values in these colonies had climbed so high that servants, when their service ended, could not expect to become economically comfortable landowners. Those who wanted to leave England turned instead to remote areas of Pennsylvania and the Carolinas, leaving the Chesapeake's tobacco-growing elite with a critical labor shortage, which in turn made the forced importation of Africans more attractive. By the later decades of the 17th century, perpetual hereditary slavery for Africans became the norm, and skin color provided Southern society's essential cleavage. For white European immigrants, regardless of poverty level, employers' harshness, arduousness of work, length remaining on their contracts, and even place of origin, whiteness meant everything. Colonial officials accepted and even looked for non-English immigrants. A handful of German colonies sprang up in Virginia and Carolina. In 1712 and 1714, Governor Alexander Spotswood of Virginia invited some German speakers to the colony's frontier region, both to serve as defenders against local Indians allied with the French and to develop an ironworks. Spotswood named the unsuccessful colony Germana. Few Germans found the region attractive. Like other Europeans, they recognized that, unable to compete with the large-scale planters who enslaved their workers, they could never experience meaningful mobility. As African slavery became a fundamental regional institution, European immigrants avoided the South. The Lower South proved somewhat more alluring to white immigrants. English immigrants steadily immigrated there, and they and their children accounted for just under half the population by 1750. Scots-Irish, Scots from the Highland region, and French Huguenots settled in South Carolina, along with English immigrants who had lived previously in various British colonies in the Caribbean, particularly Barbados. A contingent of Jews of Spanish and Portuguese background opted for South Carolina and Georgia, forming communities in Savannah and Charleston. These immigrants gravitated to those two port cities. With economies based on the lucrative Atlantic trade that linked Europe, North America, Africa, the Caribbean, and the rest of the world, Charleston and Savannah offered opportunities to newcomers with capital, appropriate skills, and business contacts. The hinterland areas did not begin to draw in immigrants until the middle decades of the 18th century. Once settled on small farms, they grew foodstuff to feed the Tidewater plantations, which concentrated on regional cash crops, rice, indigo, and tobacco. Georgia's founding provides an illustrative colonial-era immigration story. In the 1730s, James Oglethorpe, a retired British Army officer, appalled by the hordes of poor people roaming London streets and then landing in debtors' prisons, formulated a plan to found a North American colony. He would name it for the newly crowned King George III and settle it with men and some women who might prefer America over an English jail. He sold the king on the idea of Georgia as a buffer between South Carolina and native peoples who lived close by on territory occupied by the empires of Spain, to the south in Florida, and France, based in Louisiana and beyond, along the Mississippi River. Oglethorpe and the colony's trustees envisioned American life transforming poor English debtors into hardworking, self-reliant farmers. The founders banned rice cultivation, alcohol consumption, and the importation and use of African slaves, believing that slavery made white men lazy. Though the ban lasted less than a decade, Oglethorpe's efforts transported the debtors and stimulated other migrations. Officials of London's Bevis Marks Synagogue, concerned about poor Polish Jews flooding England, convinced Oglethorpe to take some of their charity cases to America as well. Thus was created Savannah's Jewish community. Oglethorpe established a village outside Savannah for German Lutherans and welcomed French Huguenots during the colony's first years. Cities and the Backcountry. Savannah and Charleston, like the other three large Atlantic coast cities, New York, Philadelphia, and Newport, Rhode Island, experienced immigration differently from the hinterlands. In the port cities, workers loaded the backcountry's lumber, fur, agricultural products, and mineral riches onto ocean-going vessels, bound mostly for England. On their return journeys, those ships brought finished goods and people, immigrants and slaves. The port cities, the predominantly English Boston an exception, attracted immigrants from a wide geographic net. Jews also came to the five cities with immigrant populations. Made up of two distinct populations, they differed from the overwhelmingly Christian majority. Jews of Spanish and Portuguese background, Sephardim, whose families had previously migrated to Amsterdam, London, and the West Indies, came first. Valued by the colonial elite for the extensive global trade they pursued with kin around the world, these merchants dominated the Jewish communities. But the majority of colonial-era Jews came from German-speaking lands, including parts of the defunct Kingdom of Poland annexed by Prussia. These Ashkenazim, meaning Germans, supported themselves as artisans and small-scale shopkeepers. Both gained rights and respect beyond those of their co-religionists back home. In these cities, all relatively small in physical size, immigrants from different places lived near each other and had to interact. They did not create dense enclaves. Rather, the city streets resounded with multiple languages. Women and men, immigrants from many places, lived cheek by jowl, needing to accommodate each other and the English. Artisans, operators of small businesses serving the broad public, and domestic servants, they needed English to communicate with employers, customers, and co-workers. Urban life fostered Anglicization at the same time that individual immigrant populations fashioned their community institutions, churches in particular. The backcountry and rural areas differed in terms of immigrant commingling. From north to south, immigrants from Ulster, Scotland, and the German-speaking lands formed relatively separate communities. Here, people from particular towns and regions back home clustered close to each other, keeping alive language, diet, and religion, living somewhat isolated from others. But whenever immigrants of this era settled, city, country, or frontier, they did not have to appeal to or curry favor with a long resident population that claimed roots that lay deep in the soil. North America's longest residents, the native people, did not constitute an elite wherever they came from and had to beg for permission to settle. Though privilege and class mattered greatly in differentiating some immigrants from others, those who came first and gained access to the most resources acknowledged their dependence on immigrants and helped enable their arrival. As in other settler societies born of European colonialism, immigrants to British North America removed by whatever means they could the people who had lived there for millennia. Their approach fully consistent with the ideology of the age. These foreigners came to America, defined it as theirs, and pushed away anyone blocking them, making this immigration era different from later ones. Likewise, the nature of work and patterns of labor rendered it distinctive. Labor and immigration, from free to bonded. Fewer than half of the immigrants came freely, in the sense that they were not bonded to someone else upon arrival. A tiny fraction had been well off before migration, but most were not. Those migrating as families generally paid their own fares and came with no obligation to an employer or ship captain. Many of these headed for New England, but every colony attracted some able to fund their own journeys and with enough money to allow them to immediately strike out on their own as farmers, artisans, or entrepreneurs. Able to take advantage of local economic opportunities and with wives, husbands, and children, all contributing to the project of making a better living in America than they could at home, they really could prosper as immigrants in the new place. At the other end of the spectrum, Africans arrived as involuntary laborers, shackled to their employers, referred to as owners. Having experienced the harrowing ordeal of capture, they endured transportation across the ocean, undergoing the harrowing Middle Passage. They took their first American steps in some Caribbean island, such as Jamaica, where planters seasoned them. From there, slavers transported them to the mainland of British North America. Sold at auction and unprotected by contract, they worked in every colony, and in places even as far north as Rhode Island, they outnumbered white bonded laborers. Everywhere, they shaped economic realities. Many northern farmers, fishermen, shipbuilders, and artisans derived their livelihoods, whether growing crops, running households, or manufacturing goods, on the backs of the enslaved. That system created a society that linked being non-white to a lack of freedom and whiteness to freedom. But freedom existed along a spectrum. In some colonies, at times, the law put white immigrant indentured servants and enslaved Africans on the same footing. Yet, even the least free white immigrants derived some modicum of legal protection from their whiteness, their contract, which fixed the term of their service, the conditions of their immigration. As early as the 1610s and extending to the Revolution, England offered some convicts the choice of remaining in prison at home or transportation to North America. This freed local communities from the expense of housing and feeding prisoners, and it reflected new ideas about punishment, the possibilities for rehabilitation under better circumstances, and the critical shortage of laborers in the colonies. About 50,000 convicts, imprisoned mostly for petty property thefts, unpaid debts, or subversive activities, agreed to go to America, hoping for physical freedom and economic improvement. Some other immigrants crossed the ocean by less than voluntary means. Ship captains, eager to fill their vessels with bodies, hired kidnappers to pluck unsuspecting men out of taverns or off streets. Local authorities in England, disturbed by hordes of vagrants clogging the roads, allowed merchants to round them up and dump them on ships bound for the colonies. But most chose to go, considering life in the colonies a reasonable choice. Reservoirs of men and women in England, elsewhere in the British Isles. And the German-speaking lands decided that only a new place would allow them to support themselves. Mostly young, they could not afford to marry, or, if married, could not sustain their families. Disadvantaged by powerful economic upheavals that undercut long-standing ways of making a living and rising birth rates, swelling numbers of people responded to spreading knowledge of American possibilities, immigrating through labor recruiting. The colony's need for labor fueled their decisions. Immigrants got their fares paid and had work waiting for them upon arrival. Earning no money while in service, they knew that upon the contract's completion, employers had to compensate them. The indenture contract detailed the required work and stipulated the employer's obligations, specifying how much food, the kind of shelter, and other necessities he promised to provide. The law protected both parties, although punishments faced by servants who ran away or did not fulfill their chores far exceeded those handed down to employers who stinted on food or reneged on payment. Most British immigrants arrived with contract in hand, knowing in advance the name of the employer and the terms of service. Parliament passed several pieces of legislation that theoretically, at least, spared them the many abuses faced by other non-British immigrants. Those coming from Europe, particularly from German-speaking lands in the 18th century, came as redemptioners. With no legal contract and unprotected by British legislation, these immigrants indebted themselves to shippers who brought them over. They negotiated the terms of employment only after landing. Potential employers gathered at the docks, hiring workers as they disembarked, then taking them away. The immigrant had to work to first pay off, or redeem, the cost of the fare. Ship owners held much power in this process, and abuses were rampant. An immigrant might arrive with a promise of work, but if the employer failed to show up at the dock, the captain would sell him off to the highest bidder. The newcomers stood on auction blocks, naked, inspected, and judged for their ability to work. German-speaking men, once established in America, turned to these same companies to bring over wives, sons, daughters, and other relatives, agreeing to pay the fares. The shippers attempted to wring as much profit as they could from this travel-now, pay-later system of transporting human cargo to America. Free and self-financed immigrants, enslaved and compelled Africans, and quasi-free indentured servants and redemptioners did colonial work. Except for the few company and government administrators stationed temporarily in the colonies, all who lived in British North America owed their presence to a demand for workers to generate profits, a goal of the British colonial project. Colonial immigration and global politics. Beyond providing a source of labor for the colonies, immigrants fit into Britain's global political strategy. Some of its North American colonies bordered on territories flying the flags of rival empires. Immigrants in the northern reaches of Massachusetts, New Hampshire, and Vermont lived at the edge of the French Empire, while those in Georgia had the Spanish colony of Florida as a neighbor. These empires vied with Britain for dominance all over the world. The immigrants to British North America, whether from England, from other parts of Great Britain, Ireland, or Scotland, or from German-speaking lands, had to defend British interests. Spanish and French colonial practices differed from those of the British. While they did recruit immigrants for their colonies, such as New France, they did so less actively or extensively than the British. At the same time, they worked more ably with native peoples, stimulating less hostility than the British, who considered immigration a solution to problems of poverty, displacement, religious dissent, political dissent, overpopulation, and mass incarceration at home. The various Indian nations, in turn, had fewer reasons to fear the French and the Spanish. The British encroached on Indians' lands, felled their forests, established towns and villages, and turned hunting grounds into farmlands for permanent settlement. The French and Spanish governments viewed their North American colonies more as places from which to extract natural resources, which demanded more positive relationships with indigenous peoples. The French and Spanish colonies witnessed higher levels of intermarriage between European men and native women, a practice that created a different dynamic from that which characterized the British zone. British administrators and investors worried constantly about Indian attacks, sure that the French and Spanish deliberately armed the Indians, who engaged in local wars to defend themselves against British settlement. the welcome extended to the women and men of Ulster, viewed by the English as primitive, wild, and warlike, reflected a desire to populate the frontier with white people ready and able to fight the Indians, equipped with weapons by Britain's rivals. Immigrants to British North America experienced four major colonial wars, starting in the 1680s and extending until the 1760s, including the French and Indian War, known also as the Seven Years' War, from 1754 to 1763. Such struggles flared around the world during this era as European nations, using their economic and military forces, confronted each other on nearly every continent. While most of this struggle for empire involved three nations, England, France, and Spain, other empires also participated in the colonization of North America, planting settlements and peopling them with immigrants. Both the Netherlands and Sweden, for example, scrambled to conquer an area along the Delaware River. Dutch families, along with the Swedes, a majority from Finland, took up land in the 1630s around what would become Wilmington, Delaware. Though neither the Dutch nor the Swedes could compete with the British for the possession of North America, their brief competition demonstrated the importance of immigrants to European imperial dreams. An episode from the 1650s shows how imperial concerns affected immigrant settlement. In 1654, a small group of Jews who had lived in Recife, in northern Brazil, fled north when Portugal seized control from the Dutch, unable and unwilling to live under this Catholic power, which in the previous century had expelled the Jews. 23 of them fled north to New Amsterdam. The Jews enjoyed protection and prosperity in Dutch colonies like Suriname, Curaçao, and Recife before the Portuguese arrived, and they expected to be welcomed in another of their colonies. Instead, Peter Stuyvesant, the Governor General, refused them for religious reasons, as he considered Jews blasphemers, deniers of Christ, and members of an accursed race, as well as for security reasons. He fretted over their Iberian origins, considering them potential spies or agents of the rival Spanish. The Dutch West India Company, which owned the colony, instructed Stuyvesant to allow them to stay, but denied Jewish men the right to serve in the guard, again questioning their loyalty. The story highlights the ways immigration in the colonial period reflected the worldwide European race for colonies. People shifted among the colonies, but usually within an empire, however far-flung. Many white people from England who immigrated to South Carolina came there from Barbados and other British Caribbean locales. Some Huguenots settled first in Nova Scotia under British rule and then made their way to New York, New Jersey, Delaware, and Virginia. Transatlantic immigration entered the strategy of British imperial policymakers. The backers of the colonies, encouraged by the government, which gave investors a fairly free hand in peopling the colonies, believed that extensive agriculture, fur trapping, foresting, and mining would ensure a victory in the global scramble for riches and empire. Britain calculated that it would secure the greatest wealth and established dominion over the largest possible territory by settling its North American colonies with people to work and fight. Although authorities in London preferred English immigrants, they simply could not find enough of those whom they desired, and they therefore began to scan a wider geography to find people to settle the land, form frontier outposts, produce wealth, and defend the empire. The French and Indian War demonstrated how immigration patterns formed over the course of the previous century affected the global politics of England and its rival France. France's North American Empire, centered primarily in Canada, had fewer than 60,000 settlers, almost exclusively French Catholics. Britain's mainland colonies boasted a population of approximately 2 million residents of diverse pre-migration backgrounds. The French relied heavily on allied Indian nations to fight for them, hence the war's name, alongside the regular French army, a force stretched thin around the globe. The British fought with contingents of local men, originally from Scotland, Ulster, and the European continent. these American soldiers of diverse backgrounds fought primarily under the command of their own officers, such as the Virginian George Washington. England won the war, expelled France from Canada, and vastly augmented its North American territory. The military victory altered administrative and fiscal policies, as the Crown and Parliament demanded greater control over colonial affairs. The colonists increasingly saw themselves as Americans, having formed a new identity that combined identification with the places they or their progenitors had come from and their diverse religious backgrounds. Religion and immigration. Religion shaped this era's immigration. Some advocates of immigration hoped that it would help spread Christianity among the native peoples. As early as the 16th century, a proponent of British colonization, Richard Hakluyt, predicted that if thriving English colonies cropped up in North America, the salvation of those poor people which have been sitting in the darkness and in the shadow of death would ensue. As Protestant English families come to North America, he predicted clergymen would surely immigrate as well. They could minister both to the immigrants and to the Indians, those he described as sitting in the darkness. The English colonies accomplished little in the conversion of the Indians to Christianity, as compared to the Catholics under the French and Spanish. Those empires made Christianization of the Indians priorities of state policy. This reflected the reality that France and Spain maintained centralized control of the colonies and dictated matters of religious practice. France disallowed the settlement of Jews or Huguenots, French Protestants of a Calvinist theological orientation, in New France. England, however, left religious matters up to the companies and proprietors of each individual colony. Those running the colonies, whether administrators sitting in London or their agents in North America, could decide whose religion might keep them from settling down and what limitations might be placed on adherence to minority faiths. The English did not prevent religious dissenters, women, and men persecuted and restricted at home from immigrating to the American colonies. Huguenots, despite being French speakers, settled comfortably in places like New York, New Jersey, and various colonies farther south, where the Church of England enjoyed official established status. Quakers, who experienced serious persecution in England, settled in many of the North American colonies besides Pennsylvania, founded by William Penn, a Quaker. Colonial Protestantism existed along a wide denominational spectrum. Protestants divided among adherents to the Church of England, Congregationalists, later Presbyterians, Methodists, Lutherans, Quakers, and Baptists. Immigrants from England included communicants of the Church of England, who predominated in the South, and Calvinists, who flocked to New England. Scots, as well as immigrants from Ulster and Wales, brought their particular churches with them, whereas German speakers were divided among Lutherans, Pietists, and Anabaptists, also referred to as Mennonites. Religion dovetailed somewhat with the various immigrants' place of origin. During much of the era, immigrants from specific places, with their distinctive religious traditions, tended to form enclaves, particularly those who settled outside the more residentially jumbled cities. Here, they lived apart from others of different religious and cultural backgrounds. In the rural and frontier regions, they mostly retained denominational commitments, worshiping in the languages familiar from their pre-migration homes. Wherever the various Protestant European immigrants came in contact with each other, they expressed hostility and disdain for the others. Whereas Peter Stuyvesant of the Dutch Reformed Calvinist religion ruled that Jews could remain but could not pray in public, he expressly forbade Lutherans from praying, even in the confines of their own homes. However wide the Protestant spectrum in terms of beliefs, rituals, languages, and places of origin, they shared a revulsion to Catholicism. In the 17th and 18th centuries, hatred of the Catholic Church, its beliefs, priests, and global structure determined who could settle and where. In addition to civil rights status, only Delaware, Pennsylvania, Maryland, and Virginia maintained no or few civil disabilities against Catholics. All the other colonies had some limitation on Catholic settlement. Some did not allow the consecration of Catholic churches. Georgia granted freedom of worship to all in its bylaws, but it stipulated, except Papists. South Carolina did the same. In 1700, Massachusetts banned Catholic priests from entering the colony, stipulating that they could face imprisonment and possible execution if they did. Such legislation reduced the numbers of Catholics willing to immigrate to British North America. The few Catholics who did tended to be English, and some Irish Catholics joined the small trickle. Knowing they faced restrictive legislation and periodic explosions of mob violence, even in colonies that did not legally disable them, stymied their immigration. The first census of the United States, conducted in 1790, put the population at about 4 million, with fewer than 65,000 Catholics estimated among them. Jews, whether of Iberian derivation from England, the Netherlands, and the various islands of the Caribbean, or from German lands, mostly of Polish background, experienced the era differently, although they also immigrated in small numbers. By the American Revolution, about 1,500 to 2,000 lived in the colonies, enduring varying degrees of political disability, but no real overt hostility, in word or deed, compared to Catholics. In some colonies, though this changed over time, they could not vote or hold public office. Other colonies, however, enacted few civic restrictions, and nowhere did the law bar them from settling down, doing business, and, if they wanted, creating congregations. Distance from European centers of Jewish life hampered their immigration. No rabbis came to North America. They faced difficulties accessing services they needed, including getting kosher meat, circumcision for male infants, and religious education for the young. All the colonies, except Rhode Island, maintained an established church, whether Congregationalism in Connecticut or Church of England in Virginia, which received tax support as the official religion. But labor needs trumped creed when it came to encouraging immigrants and fostering settlement. Colonies needed workers. Getting them settled mattered more than religious homogeneity. If Lutherans, Presbyterians, Huguenots, Anabaptists, and Jews would immigrate and enrich Pennsylvania, Maryland, South Carolina, or Georgia, then however offensive their religions, the colony's bottom line, profit, took precedence. If immigrants, whether they believed in infant or adult baptism, for example, defended the colony, then the elites and investors valued and welcomed them. Xenophobia in British North America. Yet hostility toward immigrants from one place or another flourished. Despite the reality that all Europeans had themselves immigrated from someplace, or their parents or grandparents had, each batch of newcomers confronted nasty words, defamatory images, and random violence. Common immigrant histories and shared whiteness did not prevent xenophobia and the belief, expressed everywhere at some time, that the most recent arrivals did not measure up to the imagined qualities of the earlier ones. Class played a role in this. As the colonies developed economically and needed continuous replenishments of their labor forces, indenture, redemption, and convict immigration became more common. Colonial and town officials worried that poor people disembarking at the ports would become public charges. Unable to support themselves, they would drain resources from public coffers. Modeling their policies on recently enacted British poor laws, colonial administrators limited relief to those whom they considered deserving of help, widows and orphans. They placed residency requirements on public assistance, making it impossible for newly arrived immigrants who, as a result of circumstances beyond their control, needed help. Officials dealt with immigrants who had fallen on hard times by expelling them. The numbers cannot be estimated. Commentators at the time lamented the growing number of vagrants on the roads, whom the public feared and associated with the fact of their being immigrants. immigrants tried to protect their newly arrived brethren from being labeled burdens to society. Philadelphia's German Society raised funds to erect a shelter for German immigrants, hoping to provide temporary lodging, pay off debts incurred by redemptioners, and quell animosity toward Germans. The eminent founder of the American nation, Benjamin Franklin, commented on life in Pennsylvania and offered words.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.